started. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the European Parliament. To you who are here in the building, and a big welcome to those who are joining us online. It's a very special day. I think the topic is a crucially important topic that we're going to discuss today. So I'm delighted to be here to facilitate and moderate the meeting. And my name is Grace O'Sullivan. I'm a member of the European Parliament. I'm from Ireland. I strongly associate with the issue of solidarity across Europe with humanitarians. My own background, I spent 10 years at sea with Greenpeace International. I was a crew member on a ship called the Rainbow Warrior that was bombed in New Zealand in 1985. The French government were responsible for the Secret Service, French government, to place two bombs on board. And I was a crew member, 23 years of age, and one of the crew was killed that night. I can very much empathize with the work of humanitarians. On that basis, I'm really delighted and very proud to be here today to facilitate this gathering and to hear the stories. Today is about the launch of the latest study on resilience and resistance in defiance of criminalisation of solidarity across Europe. I think the title is very apt. We have to build resilience in the global sphere we're in at the moment in terms of migration and migration pathways. And we have to also have resistance and build resistance when we are faced with obstacles that are being put in the way of those who want to carry out a humanitarian justice. So we're joined here today by colleagues from the European Parliament. We will shortly be joined by Saskia, Bricmont, the other MEP, who will join us towards the end of the presentations. And we're also, I just want to say to you, activists and humanitarians, you are amongst friends. So on that basis, I hope you can find the calm, relaxed way to do your presentations. And we're also joined by academia, by media, who are also extremely important in this topic. We're going to look at the trends across the European Union member states in terms of those who set out with an express purpose of helping some of the most vulnerable people in our society as they travel across continents and borders in search of a place of refuge and safety. So this week, Europe has witnessed some shocking scenes, which unfortunately are not new to us. At least 23 people were killed on the Moroccan border with Spain, so many that we still don't have an official number. So people with brothers, sisters, mothers, fathers, families who have lost their lives trying to cross the Moroccan border. And in the absence of any legal pathways to emigrate to Europe, they were killed at one of the many border fences and walls that have been built around our continent over the last 50 years. So in addition to those who take it upon themselves to work on these borders as humanitarians, to oppose a type of fortress Europe in peaceful and constructive ways, then now, so humanitarians are facing increasing persecution from member states and from law enforcement. In one case I've been following as a priority, because this particular case has someone, a member called Sean Binder, who is Irish-German. And so Sean and I have been in contact over the last number of years now. And in his case, a number of humanitarian workers, which some of you are probably familiar with, on the island of Lesbos, they have been charged with outrageous charges for their work relating to welcoming refugees on the island. And they were even charged with espionage for using WhatsApp to communicate. So that you can see member states are taking whatever bit of substance or tools to try to put pressure and to put charges on humanitarians carrying out their work. And so the report today, it's going to show that incidents such as these are becoming more and more common, and at least 89 people are facing charges for acts of what I call compassion and solidarity. So meanwhile, the criminalisation of human rights defenders, who in some cases are migrants themselves, remain unreported. And that, I suppose, is the importance of the media and journalists and investigative journalists also see and witness and bear witness to what is going on and to report back then these findings. So here in the European Parliament, we have very much a role in tackling this. We need to hold member states to account. We need to push back against the undemocratic expansion of Frontex, which has shown time and time again to facilitate human rights abuses on the borders without oversight. And also we need to give migrants, refugees and humanitarians facing criminalisation a voice. And that's something we can do here in the European Parliament. So it's almost like a platform and can be a platform to support the work of humanitarians. So we are going to now hear from those working in the field and hear your stories. You have approximately 6 minutes, but I don't think we're under massive pressure. So I won't be ringing any bells. So we have a number of speakers. So I will introduce the speaker, and then if you want to give the presentation, and then I'll move to the next speaker. And as I said, Saskia Bricmont will be joining us during the time she will come here beside me. So without further ado, I am going to bring to your attention our first speaker, who is Marta Gionco, one of the authors of this study, which we have many copies of here, this study here. And Marta is an advocacy officer at the Platform for International Cooperation on Undocumented Migrants, and has put a lot of time and research into the study on criminalisation of solidarity in Europe. So I will hand over to Marta. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. O'Sullivan, for the very welcome remarks. And thank you also to the Greens EFA group for inviting me and for giving us the opportunity to work on this study. The report was co-written with Jelka Kretzschmar, who I believe is also online, so she will also be able to reply to any questions afterwards in the chat. I have some slides, so I was wondering if we could maybe share them, so I'm going to also use them during my presentation. Thank you also all for being here, and also thank you to the people who are joining us remotely. Our report has three main objectives. First of all, we tried through this report to really unpack what it means criminalization of solidarity, to understand what do we mean when we talk about hostile environment, and in particular to understand how many people are concerned by this phenomenon, because we think the data is really important to have solid policies as well, and I will go more into the difficulties of this task afterwards. The second objective was to also highlight in particular how migrants who act in solidarity with other migrants are even more criminalized and disproportionately hit by these policies. So we have a specific focus on migrants' rights defenders. And thirdly, we try to identify specific actions which could be taken by the EU to address this phenomenon. And therefore, in my presentation, I'm going to follow these three objectives. The report is quite long, so I was invited to look at the report itself, because, of course, there is much more, including also some examples of resilience, in particular by human rights defenders and migrants themselves. Starting with the first objective, if you could please move to the next slide. Thank you. If we look at figures, figures are important to understand how many people are affected, but figures are also really difficult to find. The methodology that we adopted is based on media monitoring, as well as interviews, qualitative interviews with 15 human rights defenders in 10 member states. However, we have to say from the beginning that our report is not exhaustive. There may very well be cases which have been undetected by our media monitoring. And we also know that there are a lot of cases which are not reported for several reasons, including because people do risk when they share the cases with the media. They may risk to have limited access to the territory. They may risk personal consequences for their and their families. They may risk not being able to do the work they do. So this is why we know that this is really the tip of an iceberg, and probably many more cases are out there. And we also know that it is particularly true for migrants' rights defenders, because the risks they face when they speak up are even bigger. With these caveats, we did still try to look for some figures, because we know that figures are important, and we found that between January of 2021 and March of 2022, at least 89 people were criminalized in the EU. And the vast majority of them, which is 88% of these 89 people, were criminalized on charges which are related to migrant smuggling, which in the EU is defined as criminalisation of the facilitation of entry, transit and stay, irregular entry, transit and stay in the EU. Secondly, we could move to the next slide, please. So this was the slide with the numbers, and then the next one, please. Yes, the second thing that we try to do is really to understand, when we talk about hostile environment, what are the elements that contribute to that? Because we know that it's not just one thing, it's a lot, a combination of a lot of different aspects which create a very hostile environment for migrants and for people who act in solidarity with them. And we see that at the very roots of criminalization of solidarity is the criminalization of migration themselves. Because migrants are increasingly considered as criminal in policies, in the narratives, they are portrayed as a threat to national security, even if we know that this is not true. People who act in solidarity with them are also considered as criminals. And this is also reflected in the recommendations that I will share afterwards. The second element that we see that contributes to an hostile environment is the fact that states use, and also we can say abuse, administrative and criminal laws to prosecute human rights defenders, as well as migrants themselves. And in particular, as I mentioned before, they use counter-smuggling laws for these purposes. Thirdly, we see, and this is a more general trend, which does not only affect organizations working with migrants, but we see in the EU in many states, a shrinking of the civic space, which means that there is less freedom of expression, less freedom of association, less freedom of assembly. And all of this makes it more difficult for human rights defenders to act when they are criminalized, to mobilize people around them and to challenge the system and to challenge the laws that are used against them. The fourth element that we identified is the lack of independent human rights monitoring. And I know this is something that the European Parliament is also working very actively on in the context of EU Pact on Migration and Asylum. Because in many countries there is no independent human rights monitoring, not just any human rights monitoring, but a real independent one, we see that there is more impunity when migrants and human rights defenders are criminalized. And the fifth element that we identify is access to resources. So when organizations have limited funds, this decreases the civic space, this leads to more precariousness for the work of NGOs. Could we please move to the next slide? Thank you. So as I mentioned, these five elements lead to an hostile environment for migrants and people defending them. And the second focus of our report is looking at how migrants who act in solidarity with other migrants face much more severe consequences. So we think it's really important when we talk about criminalization of solidarity to not only look at European human rights defenders, but also look at non-European human rights defenders, because we know that the consequences can be much harder. When there are legal proceedings, even when they end in acquittals, we know that this can have a very long impact, long life impact on migrants' rights defenders. They may risk the opportunities that they have to live regularly in the EU. They may be excluded from asylum and other residence procedures. They may also face very harsh socioeconomic consequences. They may lose their jobs, they may lose their housing, and I think some speakers will share more on some of these cases afterwards. We also see that because of institutionalized racism, when people who are accused of smuggling are migrants themselves, they face much harsher consequences for very similar facts. And in trials, they face much more violations of the right to fair trial, including very long pretrial detention. And the report collects a lot of cases which really testimony to that. And thirdly, linked to what I mentioned before, it's much harder to document the criminalization of migrants themselves, because migrants are often pushed back or deported before they can access any effective remedy, and because generally they face much harsher risk when they speak up, in particular if the situation is precarious or irregular. Some data which I think is very telling of the magnitude of this phenomenon is data collected by organizations at national level. In Italy, the organizations Arci Porco Rosso and Alanfon found that at least 1,000 migrants have been criminalized in the last decades. And we're talking mainly about boat drivers who have been identified on the basis of very flimsy evidence, on the basis of very unclear photographs, and who have gone through years of judicial trials. Many of them then have been acquitted, but the consequences, as I mentioned before, are still very harsh. And we have also seen that in Greece, as also highlighted by Borderline Europe, there have been a 100% increase in the use of counter-smuggling legislation in 3 years, from 2016 to 2019. The criminalization of migrants and the use of anti-smuggling legislation against migrants is not only typical of these two countries. We also identified cases, for instance, in the Netherlands and in Romania, but we're sure that there are many more out there that are not reported yet. Could we please move to the next slide, please? To conclude, I would like to share some recommendations. And as I mentioned before, because we see that the hostile environment is composed of very different elements, at the basis of which is the criminalization of migration itself, to react to this, we don't only have one solution. We need to really look at a plethora of different actions that can be undertaken by the EU. And only the combination of all of these can actually help us to tackle this phenomenon. So I again encourage you to look at the report, because I think we have around 8 pages of recommendations. I'm not going to read all of them now, and I'm going to highlight the 5 main ones. First of all, it's essential to prevent the criminalization of humanitarian assistance. This includes many legal and policy reforms, but in particular, it requires amending the definition of smuggling. It's important that when we talk about smuggling, we only talk about situations in which there is unjust enrichment. And why do we talk about unjust enrichment and not only any financial benefit? Is because if we talk about unjust enrichment, we can also exclude the criminalization of service providers to undocumented people, because we know that nowadays even renting a flat or giving a lift or a taxi to undocumented people can lead to accuses of smuggling. So this is why we think that it's important to include the element of unjust enrichment to prevent the exclusion of undocumented people from services. Secondly, it's essential to cultivate the civic space. And this includes developing different legal and policy tools to ensure that human rights defenders are protected from retaliation. And we have some concrete suggestions in the report on how this could be done. Thirdly, it's important to have data, again, and going back to what I said at the beginning. And for that, we think it's really important that the institutions also take an active role in collection of data. Building an evidence base on how many people are affected by criminalization of solidarity, building an evidence base on how the EU Facilitation Directive is used and how this is used against migrants and against human rights defenders. And this also means implementing effective human rights monitoring. The fourth recommendation is linked to funding for NGOs, in particular for migrant-led NGOs, which are also particularly excluded from accessing fundings, and funding for human rights monitoring. And last, but definitely not least, is also promoting a balanced EU migration policy. It is important to change the narrative, to change the way in which we talk about migration. It's also important to take very concrete actions to end racism and also to decriminalize migration. I'm going to stop here, and I'm happy to reply to any questions afterwards. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Marta. And we'll have the questions at the end after all the speakers. And for those who are joining us online, you can put your questions into the chat. Yeah, once again, thanks for the report. Hopefully everyone will get a chance to read it and react on it, because that's the importance of today. So our next speaker now is Tajana Tadic. And Tajana is joining us here in the room, and Omar Essa Mahdi is joining us online, and that's their partners. So Tajana is a human rights defender working in Croatia, where human rights abuses against migrants have been reported in massive numbers now. And so Tajana's partner Omar has had his refugee status revoked, and was forced to leave Croatia, facing deportation to Iraq. So Tajana, if you would like to give us your input, and then, as I said, Omar is online, and is available for questions. Please, over to you, Tajana.
We will just show a very quick video from Omar that he sent to us. Thanks again. And then Tajana Okiko.
Sorry, I need a minute because the sound is not working, as you all can hear.
Just bear with us for a moment while we try to get Omar's video coming in.
Then in the meanwhile, let me just tell you how lucky you are online and also being here, because you have people sitting here with you that are actually also in the study and that are willing here to share their stories with you. And I think that's really exceptional, because we're not talking about something theoretical here. We're talking about real lives. And oh, now it's working. One of the real lives we're talking about. Okay.
Thank you for giving me a chance to speak publicly about my situation. 2 minutes is a very short time to explain everything, but I will do my best. In 2022, 7 years after I came to Europe, I find myself without any protection again. I lived my life with my partner, I worked, I paid my taxes, and I committed no crime. My life was turned upside down because I refused to become informant for the security intelligence agency, and the retribution of the Croatian state. Because I refused, endanger my life. My asylum was taken for no other reason than this. They said I was a threat to national security without providing any real evidence for this. I stayed as long as I could to fight my case, but when it became clear they would deport me to Iraq, even before the case is finished, I had to flee again. I thought I found my safety in Croatia. I had dreams building my life there, and all of this destroyed by the stroke of the pen. I decided to speak about this just this because there is always the chance that might be happening to the other people and might be not have the support that I have. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Omar, for your contribution. Even though, as you said, you just had 2 minutes, I think you you definitely filled that very much and gave us an overview of the difficulties you're facing. So now we go over to Tiana.
Thank you very much for the warm welcome here today. And thank you to Omar, who is, I think, also following us online, in addition to sending us a video. So he couldn't be here with us today because he cannot travel, as he's, again, an asylum seeker in Germany 7 years after he came to Europe. And I would like to echo something that both he and Marta said, and this cannot be overstated. And this is the fact that refugees and migrants, people on the move, are the primary targets of criminalization. Yet the support they receive is nowhere near the support and publicity that we get as white Europeans. And this is why I would like to express my gratitude to the MEPs who facilitated this study and for the authors, to the authors who wrote it, for including these cases of criminalization in it. So to give you a bit of history about our case and what happened in Croatia. I have been the target of criminalization attempts by the Ministry of Interior since 2018, when I publicly demanded justice for Madina Husseini after her tragic death. And I put a lot of efforts into supporting the Husseini family, as well as demanded accountability from the Croatian government regarding pushbacks and other human rights violations that are happening in Croatia. So I won't go into all of the instances of harassment that happened all of the years because this will fill out the whole thing. But I would just like to highlight a few. One time after we scheduled a press conference, where we were supposed to speak about police pressures on CSOs and lawyers representing the family, the police were sent to our homes that afternoon, and they demanded that we come in for questioning the next day at the same time as the conference was scheduled to happen. Of course, we held the conference and we told the police, you can come to arrest us if you would like, but we will hold it anyway and see you later. Another example is the fact that I was routinely questioned by the police with the implication that I am colluding with smugglers, because terrified people were coming to our office regularly, and they were too scared to go to a police station to ask for asylum because they would be pushed back, not at the border, but from the capital of a European member state. And additionally, sometimes during these questionings would be very strange and very hostile, and I was asked also inappropriate questions about my ethnicity during this questioning. And as a national minority in Croatia, you can imagine this wasn't very comfortable. And the majority of this harassment that was happening actually occurred in the context of the public advocacy and strategic litigation in the case of Madina Husseini, as well as the public advocacy against pushbacks and other human rights violations in Croatia. And all of this was not in our imagination. In November 2021, in the case of MH and others versus Croatia, the European Court of Human Rights found actually that Croatia violated 5 human rights of the Husseini family, including Medina's right to life and the inhuman treatment of her family, her brothers and sisters. And this verdict additionally highlighted concerns about the intimidation which was perceived by the civil society organizations and activists who are providing aid to people on the move. And the court further found that the lawyer of the Husseini family was subject to state pressure aimed at discouraging pursuit of Medina's case. But to go back to how this affected Omar, who is incidentally my partner. So he experienced harassment by the authorities, among them the threat of revocation of asylum and deportation to Iraq, when he refused to share information on other refugees informally, and in essence, when he refused to become an informant for the security and intelligence agency. Now, we didn't think that these threats would actually materialize in reality, but unfortunately, the initial official decision from the Ministry of Interior came in May of 2020, and it was an absolute shock. Not so much the fact that they went through with it. This is something that we discussed might happen to him after they have exhausted other avenues of targeting me. What was shocking was the way in which it was done and the lies that were used to do it. So his refugee status was revoked, and it was based on allegations that he represents a threat to national security and public order of the Republic of Croatia, that he has misrepresented his sectarian affiliation and the potential danger he would face in Iraq. And they even went as far as to claim that there's potential for him to commit a terrorist act. So neither he nor our legal representative have been given access to part of his file, which is, of course, classified as secret. And to this day, we do not know what is in this file. Additionally, we had expert opinions and official documents which substantiated his claims, which proved that he was telling the truth, as well as witnesses whom we suggested to the court, but they were not even considered to be reviewed or heard during the court proceedings. So in January 2021, the administrative court in Zagreb, Croatia, dismissed our appeal against the revocation of Omar's refugee status and ignored the entire body of evidence that we provided to support our claims. The whole verdict of 9 pages was based on one sentence saying that the judge read the secret file, which we could not see, and that she agrees with it. Nothing else. She didn't go into the merits of the case or anything else. And furthermore, Omar was instructed to voluntarily leave the European Economic Area within 30 days of the day on which the decision becomes enforceable, or he would be subject to forced removal. He filed a request, we filed a request to have this 30-day period extended, as we have, of course, appealed the case further to the High Administrative Court, and his presence might be necessary for the court hearings. Unfortunately, he has not received an answer for the sector of border police, whom I have also publicly criticized. Even after, we were assured that all of the documents for the request were both sent and received in time. And it's just to note that these requests were routinely approved, especially at the height of the COVID-19 pandemic. And in any case, we should have been notified even if the answer was no, but no answer at all came. So, fearing deportation to Iraq, because the Croatian government really showed that they were ready to deport him, he had no choice but to flee Croatia. And eventually he sought international protection in Germany, where we have immense support from Borderline Europe, who you mentioned in your presentation. And unfortunately, the authorities there sought to return him to Croatia according to the Dublin procedures. And after initially declining this request for a Dublin return, Croatia claimed that Omar is a threat to national security, we revoked his asylum, we don't want him back. Then Germany made another request, and on the 24th of December, on Christmas Eve, they were working very hard, they accepted this return. And of course, we appealed it at the administrative court, and in particular, because his return to Croatia might mean refoulement to Iraq, where he would likely face torture, inhuman and degrading treatment, and even death. So at the moment, we have an interim measure from the Berlin Administrative Court, which has ordered that the Federal Office for Refugees and Migrants cannot go on with the Dublin return. But we are still waiting for this final decision from the court regarding this. And of course, there's the whole issue of him having to go through an asylum procedure all over again after 7 years of being in Europe, having status. And this is, of course, raking up all sorts of past traumatizing events for him. So to recap, He refused to become an informant for the Security and Intelligence Agency, and suddenly he became a threat to national security. Even after going all of the mandatory security checks during his asylum process in Croatia, where none of these issues arose. So he got a positive decision from the Security and Intelligence Agency, who is heavily involved in the asylum procedure in Croatia. So this refusal, paired with the fact that the government is well aware that he is my partner and I am the proverbial thorn in their side, has led us to our current situation, which is exile. And the frameworks in which we operate as human rights defenders are indeed shrinking spaces. And there isn't an institution on whose door we didn't knock to help us, from the parliamentary committees in Croatia to the president's office. 37 members of this parliament wrote to Croatia's Prime Minister Andrej Plenković, yet nothing happened, nothing changed. I believe all they received was an answer from the Minister of Police, David Božinović, that he was shocked that this was happening, and it's the Security and Intelligence Agency for sure doesn't operate like that. We also tried with the Ombudsperson's Office in Croatia, who took 8 months to reply to us and then told us to lodge a complaint with the police. And it would be quite funny if it wasn't so tragic. And this devastation that happened was really another lesson in the true precariousness of life in Europe, particularly for racialized people and particularly for refugees and migrants. And we have learned that this veil that separates our regular lives from total chaos is wafer thin. But we still hold out hope that we will get through this, and while we hold hope, we will continue to fight. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much, Tiana, for sharing your story and Omar's story. And, you know, I think we can all sense the frustration and difficulty you face. So thank you for that. We move now to closer to Brussels, to Robin, who's closer to me. And Robin Bronlet is from Progress Lawyers Network. And Robin's going to talk to us about cases here in Belgium and give us an insight into discrimination in the justice system itself. So over to you, Robin.
Thank you very much. I was interviewed for the study mainly about a case I was involved in, which was which made quite a lot of noise in Belgium and internationally. It was a case back in which started in 2017 until 2021, in which eight undocumented migrants, as well as four volunteers who were Belgian nationals or legal residents in Belgium, were charged with the smuggling. It made a lot of noise because some of the volunteers were members of the Plateforme Citoyenne de Soutien des Réfugiés, which had quite a lot of members and which was had a lot of support in Belgian civil society. These people were the migrants were charged with smuggling, and the volunteers were charged with assisting, being accomplices to smuggling. Even though no significant amount of money was exchanged, these were people, undocumented migrants, who were helping each other and locate and get into trucks that were leaving for the United Kingdom. All of the undocumented migrants were, of course, immediately detained in pre-trial detention, which is not a surprise when you've read the report and when you know that our societies have broadly accepted the fact that it's normal to put somebody who is undocumented in detention for very long periods of time without them being convicted of a crime, be it pre-trial detention or detention for administrative and migration reasons. Of the volunteers, the two of them who were white Belgian were not put in pretrial detention, but of the two others, one had a double nationality, Moroccan and Belgian nationality. She was put in pretrial detention for 2 months. And the fourth volunteer did not have the Belgian nationality. He was a legal resident in Belgium for more than 17 years, but he still had his Tunisian nationality, and he had to stay in pretrial detention for 8 months. The four volunteers ended up being acquitted, completely cleared of all crimes. This was confirmed in appeal. So this detention is especially shocking, considering that they would end up being considered completely innocent. This was, of course, a victory to obtain this this acquittal, because it was really scary for these people to be charged and detained in this way. Now, unfortunately, the 8 undocumented migrants were all convicted, even though, as I said, there was no, the decision noted that there was no significant amount of money exchanged. Now, this is a good example to talk about the Belgian law, which on paper is actually probably one of the most protective of human rights defenders. Because first off, the facilitation of illegal entry or illegal stay is not criminalized if it is done for mainly humanitarian reasons. Mainly humanitarian reason is, it's quite a broad humanitarian compared to what exists or doesn't exist in other countries. That's one thing. Now, there is a second article, which is actually the transposition of the facilitation directive, which criminalizes smuggling, but only if the suspect is pursuing a financial advantage, which is not a condition that is included in the facilitation directive. So the Belgian law is more more restrictive than the directive. Unfortunately, it allows for the financial advantage to be direct or indirect. And what this means in this case, and in actually virtually all cases, or most cases where undocumented people are charged as smugglers, is that the prosecution and the judges consider that when you're helping each other illegally cross a border, even though I'm not paying you and you're not paying me, but we are helping each other, we are each going to benefit from this exchange by securing our own illegal passage to the United Kingdom. And this concept of self-smuggling is considered an indirect financial advantage, because instead of having to pay a smuggler, I'm going to smuggle myself for free, and I'm getting an indirect financial advantage. Now, in this, in the case that I was speaking about, the decision, and especially the Court of Appeals decision, really explicitly mentions that they recognize this concept of self-smuggling, and they mention that actually the sentencing should not be too harsh, considering what they are used to, because the people are themselves they are actually authors and victims of the same crime. Now, a sentence that is not too harsh is as like 1 year prison sentence. So it's just not too harsh compared with what we are used to in other smuggling cases. Now, This reduced sentencing was certainly the result of the really high media and civil society attention around this case, because some volunteers and especially some white European volunteers were also being targeted. So the at least the migrants were benefiting from that. Fortunately, this is the only case where the Brussels prosecutor's office has charged volunteers. But unfortunately, this means that in all the other cases that are coming through the tribunals every week, there is virtually no support, no media attention around the suspects who are undocumented migrants themselves, and these people are being convicted based on the concept of self-smuggling, and they are getting sentences of 5 years up to 7 years jail time. As you know, when you are undocumented, first off, you have a higher risk of a longer pretrial detention, but you also have reduced or no access to conditional libération conditionnelle. To basically the way that the conditional release, the way that the Belgian authorities are trying to reduce the chronic overpopulation in the Belgian prison system is by allowing most people serving a sentence to get out after a third of the sentence, which also means that the judges are taking that into account when they are setting the sentencing and setting a higher sentencing. But of course, people who are undocumented, it's virtually impossible for them to get access to this, to get out after a third. So it means that they are going to have to serve a really long prison sentence. And it also means that they risk losing, basically, even if they somehow get persuaded to try an asylum request in Belgium while they are being detained, they risk this request being rejected based on the fact that they were convicted for a long sentence and for a crime which is considered a particularly heinous and grave crime, because it involves, of course, exploiting the weakness of victims who themselves are undocumented migrants. So yeah, this is an example of the situation in Belgium. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Robin. So look, first I'd like to welcome Saskia to the table, and Saskia will speak to us later. But I'm just going to move ahead in because we of time. So we have now Charlotte Kwantes, who's the national coordinator of the NGO Utopia 56, who are well known for working in solidarity with people who arrive in France. So Charlotte, I'm going to hand over to you now, straight away. Thank you.
I'm here.
Oh, you're there. Sorry. Well, very good. Off you go.
Okay. Thank you for having me first. I'm going to talk about the situation in Northern France at the UK border, as I work for a grassroots French organization, Utopia 56, working in 8 different locations, but one of our main actions takes place on the French side of this border in Calais, where people are stuck there in informal camps, trying to cross the channel to go to the UK. And at this place in France, we see for many years lots of police pressure and harassment on people, on migrants in the first place, of course, but also on helpers. And this, I have 2 examples. One is quite recent and took place a few months ago. when we found, our teams found 10 young men who just came back from being rescued in the sea after trying to cross the channel. So they were all wet and traumatized and scared and exhausted on the side of the road, and our teams saw them, so they stopped to bring assistance. And there were three cars of our teams. So they parked on the side of the road and checked the guys and brought them food and dry clothes and blankets. Then the police came, they checked that everything was fine and they just left afterwards. And a few days later, we got three fines for parking on the side of the road, whereas we were just bringing assistance. So it's one example, but another one was more in the during the lockdown and curfew period. So from March 2020 and May 2021, our organization, volunteers from our organization, 43 of them, got in total 119 fines for not respecting the sanitary measures and going out. And so all this, we see that as a very like a systemic strategy of targeting volunteers while they are helping displaced people, giving them food or bringing them in their cars. And at the end of this, like the total of this fine, represent roughly 20,000 euros that the organization choose to pay if finally we lose the cases, because for each of them, roughly each of them, we try to contest every single fines. But it's a lot of work. It's a lot of paperwork, and it can be a lot of money as well. So we see that as an attempt to the organization to make the organization more fragile, but also to strategy of dissuasion, targeting young people, young volunteers who are between 18 and 25 years old. They come to Calais just to help people. And basically the French authorities tell them that what they are doing is either illegal or unnecessary, and that anybody trying to help migrants in Calais is not welcome here, because these people, displaced people, are not welcome either. So it's like a phenomenon that we see in Northern France for years now. And it doesn't stop, actually, because we keep getting fines, and every association working there keep getting fines for very absurd and almost no reason. And so we see that helpers are target of the French authorities. And at the end of that, it means that people are afraid to come and help. People are afraid to protest. They're afraid to take action and take position against the French actions. And it weakens the engagement that we can have towards migrants. And of course, the first victim of that are, as you said in your report, are displaced people, whose access to their fundamental rights is more and more and more limited. And I think that we think as you show in your report, that this serves the bigger goal to criminalize migration at the end, and that it's like a dead angle that is not reported or not enough. And another difficulty that we face is that our cases of fines can be seen as really small cases, and it's isolated, and these volunteers don't have any communication power and no legal support, so it's really hard to document it and to face on a legal basis or on the communication aspect as well. And that's it for me. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Charlotte. So we'll move ahead now with the next speaker. But just before I do, I'd like to welcome Tineke Streck from the Netherlands, who is one of another of our MEPs. So welcome to you. So now we're going to go to the El Hebrew 3 case, which has been ongoing now for 3 years in Malta, where three people continue to face criminalization and pressure for their role in the direction of a commercial ship, which was picked up, which picked up people in the Mediterranean Sea. And the case underlines the injustice of the European Union's attitude towards Libya and the people who are forced back to that country where human rights abuses are rampant. And so activist and a professional in art and design, Jelka Kretzschmar, will talk about this case. So Jelka, you're very welcome.
Thank you so much. Thanks for inviting us. My name is Jelka. I'm part of the Free El Hiblu 3 campaign, and with me online is also Chetta Mainwaring, who couldn't join in person today. I want to share with you the story of those three friends of mine, Amara, Kader, and Abdallah, who live in Malta, who have to sign in with the police on a daily basis, who have to attend court hearings every month. They have jobs, they have families, they have friends, but they're not free. And they obviously cannot come here themselves because their asylum procedures are ongoing and a trial is ongoing. The three arrived in Malta in March 2019, 2 days after being rescued by a merchant vessel in the central Mediterranean from a sinking rubber boat. The sinking rubber boat or the rescue of the merchant vessel was instructed by European patrol aircraft to rescue the people on board. Not everybody on board that sinking rubber boat onboarded the merchant vessel. Some people stood behind and are disappeared since. The people that onboarded were told that they would be brought to Europe, that they would be brought to safety, but after a while they realized that the tanker would steer south and would realize that they were heading towards the Libyan shores, a place where people are facing torture, arbitrary detention, rape, slavery, all sorts of arbitrary killings, even as daily occurrences in the camps. Not a single organization or official body in the world considers Libya a safe place for people on the move, not the United Nations, not the European Commission. And the international law of the sea says people rescued from distress at sea have to be brought to this place of safety, right? So the people on board the merchant vessel, they protested. Most of them spoke Bambara, some speak French, spoke French, West African languages mainly. Only a few people on board the ship spoke enough English to converse with the crew and to express their concerns, their fears of being brought back to this place. So the people that spoke English, they tried to translate, they tried to mediate between a scared crew and scared passengers not to be brought back to the hellhole of the Libyan detention camps, until eventually the ship, the merchant vessel, steered north and headed towards Malta, where the ship was stormed immediately, and the three boys, by then they were 15, 16, and 19 years old, were arrested, handcuffed with cable ties, and thrown into a high security wing in prison without knowing what is going on. The day before, or 2 days before, while they were still at sea, the story about the rescue had broken international news. In Italy, the narrative was seeded of piracy. In other countries, the narrative was supported. Was told that people would have hijacked the tanker and were described as pirates and criminals. And once arriving in Malta, the Maltese authorities obviously replicated this discourse by arresting them. That has nothing to do with the reality. So many of us, people from different NGOs, human rights defenders, decided that we have to do something about it.
So we started to working on a campaign which was launched the year after their arrival on the 29th of March in 2020. By that time, and this was important to us, the three were also released on bail, so we could converse and work inclusively, discuss together what strategy we would go for. So we're not advocating on behalf of them, but we're working together on this campaign. Yeah, we're all familiar with the legal institution of self-defense. We are allowed to defend ourselves against an attack or an attack against a fellow human being. And if at all, if we look at the scenario on the ship, the three young men acted in self-defense when they tried to converse with the crew, not accepting the fact that they would be subject to an illegal pushback to Libya, that their rights would be trampled on. So it takes courage to stand up for one's human rights, especially when one has just escaped torture, death, potential drowning at sea. So these El Hiblu 3's actions demand our respect. People's resistance against human rights abuses deserve attention, deserve celebration. They're not ethically and morally justified, but also legally, as we've just seen in the Vostra Lassa case, for example, which had a similar scenario where people were resisting an illegal pushback and the Court of Cassazione in Italy ruled in their favor. To us, the El Hiblu 3 are heroes, and we take them as an example. We think it's all our responsibility not to remain silent, not to look away, but to oppose to the dismantling of human rights, to guarantee that people don't drown on their way to Europe or get criminalized upon arrival. As part of that assignment, our campaign has recently set up a freedom commission with international human rights defenders, advocates, lawyers, people from different institutions, academics, legal scholars, people from churches. We have published a book 3 months ago on the case to outlining the broader context and criminalization of migration. There should be also books, I think, to the EP on the way. The book has also been gifted by the El Hiblu 3 to the Pope when they met recently in Malta, which was a big step for us to raise awareness. And the former president of Malta, Marie-Luz Calero, has just released an opinion piece last week on the case and its unfair conditions during the trial. Multiple witnesses in the past 3 years of pre-trial have confirmed that nothing happened on the ship but translation and mediation from the side of the three. And no evidence has been seen that supports the charges. So we're at the moment right now where the pre-trial is about to terminate and we're still hoping for a dismissal before a bill of indictment will be filed. And to continue to advocate for the dismissal of all the 9 charges that are brought against the El Hiblu 3, that might be brought against the El Hiblu 3, we need the support of official bodies, of entities. We urge the European Commission to speak up against this case and to dismiss the political motivated trial in Malta and give the three their freedom back. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jelka. And to move now to Michele LeVoy. What's her?
Questions. Question time.
Oh, we do question time first. Okay, well, there we go. We're going to do question time first. There's probably questions on the screen. And probably questions in the room. So I'm going to hand over to Saskia now. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Grace. And thank you all for attending. Apologies, I came in late, but of course I already read the study and heard the latest interventions. I will now open the floor to question and answers in the room, and we already got some questions through the chat. So if any hand raises quickly, I'll let you ask your questions. Otherwise, I'll let you think about your questions, and I go to one in the chat. The first question we receive from Tinegre Willemsen in the chat is, it a good idea to enshrine the right to rescue into international law? Is it realistic? And is there any chance this can happen? Who would like to answer that question? Would you go?
I can go briefly and then maybe we let other people come in as well. I think it's clear that it's not only a right but an obligation to rescue under international maritime law, and I think we have to maybe, it could be useful to start thinking about not only what the rights to act are, but also what the obligations to act are. And saving lives is an obligation under international maritime law. Rescuing people is an obligation. Bringing them to a place of safety is an obligation. And I think under most of the national system, intervening is an obligation too, and not intervening in situations in which people are at risk is an obligation too. And therefore I would say, yes, absolutely, it should be a right, but we should also remember that NGOs and individuals are doing what states should be obliged to do, and we have to maybe also go back to that and remember that we are acting because people who should be acting are not doing their duty. And I will let maybe other people add something if they wish.
Yeah, well, thanks a lot for the presentation. Also, my apologies from my side that I entered late into this event. But I would like to know, maybe from you, Jelka, and maybe also others, about independent institutions in the member states, like Ombudsman, etc. Are they open for complaints, and what do they do in order to support you with access to justice, or also to undertake their own actions towards the authorities?
Maybe I should be the. I can start. As I mentioned, the Ombudsperson's office in my intervention. Unfortunately, the situation, as you know, in Croatia is quite difficult, and the Ombudsperson's office also experienced extreme difficulty in trying, you know, to have oversight of police work and so on. And so for me, it was extremely frustrating that our case didn't receive support. We had to wait 8 months for an answer to our complaint. And then in the end, we were just told to complain to the police. So to the same institution who was persecuting us and who was hindering the work of the Ombudsperson's office itself. So, I don't know, maybe this is the specific case of Croatia, where a lot of the institutions are actually complicit in actually covering up, you know, the human rights violations. So,
exactly. This is actually what I'm a bit looking for. Is there any regression if it comes to the development of level of independence of national institutes? Of course, we know from the pressure in Croatia, also in Greece, but, you know, other member states, is there still, you know, are they still the reliable partner and actor to work with?
I think it's a good question. Very honestly, I don't really have a good answer, to be honest. I think there's something we have to follow up on. We're in touch with a lot of independent organizations with legal coordinating bodies, for example, transnational organizations. We haven't been following up much with an ombudsperson, also particularly, I think, because we're still in a pre-trial phase and knowing right now what we're facing. At the moment, we're mobilizing around the Children's Commissioner. This is something that we have to go for because we have two minors that were involved, but it's something we will follow up on. I'm sorry, I don't have a very clear answer.
Thank you. Any other question in the room?
Yes, hello. Thanks a lot for having this discussion. It's extremely important. On the activist side, it's a major issue, major. So I have one point that goes a bit along with what's just been said now, and another question. The point is, honestly, when you see recommendations that talk about monitoring here, monitoring there, what's the point of monitoring when there are no sanctions? There have been monitored, and I don't know the right word in English, but there are proofs of what happened in Greece, pushbacks in Libya. There are proofs, there have been reports. Journalists have made huge investigations about it. There are proofs and there are no sanctions. I mean, a guy like the ex-director of Frontex, he leaves, and what does it say? Commission or whoever, oh, now he's gone, there's no need for further inquiry. So I'm a bit annoyed about that. So I go along with nice recommendations year after year in one field, another field. What about sanctions? You know, only we know that there are pressure. And also that comes to my other question, is there any work done somewhere about the fact that it's actually a European strategy to criminalize? Because whether you go to Germany, to France, we have several examples. Here we talk about Malta, we can go in, I think in Croatia, whatever country, this criminalization is an actual strategy. And is there any work or research on that point? Thank you.
Or would you like to collect a few, or I should have?
Go ahead.
Yeah. I think it's, I fully agree with you. I think it's a very key part of monitoring is accountability, and accountability comes with sanctions. And I believe that everyone in this room also agrees that we need to have sanctions. I think the Parliament is also doing a lot of work on accountability of Frontex. There is need to for more accountability. I think having evidence is the first step, but it's not the only step. I cannot but agree more. I believe that for that, legal changes are also needed. But I think we also know that in the current context, legal changes are difficult. I think within which directions legal changes are happening now in the context of all new migration policies which are being revised. So I think we also have to acknowledge that legislation is already there. We already have, you know, a broad legislation that should be used more. The problem is political will and judicial will. But I think also a very interesting initiative in the context of sanction is, for instance, the fact that some lawyers brought the EU before the International Criminal Court, and there have been efforts in that regard. And I think it's, as I mentioned before, I think it's not only one step that is needed. I think it's really a combination of different steps, and monitoring and having sanctions and the judicial system together with other organizations which might not have the power to impose sanctions, but may still have a very important role in collecting the evidence that can be brought to the judicial system. So I hope that answers, but I think this was more maybe a comment rather than a question. Thanks.
Thank you very much. And of course, we can just agree with your remark and your answer. And it's very important that we continue to do that in the different legislations we can influence and work on, but also in the recommendations of your study is implementation, proper monitoring, and having an independent body at EU level to monitor human rights violations. And this was one question to me, but maybe, and sorry for that, if you addressed this issue earlier, my question would be, would you see a new body, or would you see conversions between existing bodies working together, or maybe how would you concretely, if you had to create that oversight body, how would you do to do that? And I have another question coming in the chat on the EU regulation. Why is there still no difference between smuggling for financial profit on the one hand and smuggling, helping people without financial profit? And you also mentioned that issue. So I don't know who would like to reply both questions, or maybe having different answers. You go ahead.
Yes, thank you. I will maybe start with the second question, and then I can say something on the first one. But I think on the first question you asked, it's really probably a joint discussion that could be we could also have in the next months or so. Mm-hmm. So, because I think we have to really brainstorm collectively on what can be done concretely. We have a lot of different suggestions. But starting from the second question. Under international law, the UN protocol establishes that smuggling should only be criminalized if there is financial benefit. Now, at the EU level, the Facilitation Directive, which was adopted in 2002, considers two different scenarios. If you are facilitating the irregular residence of someone in the EU, then there must be financial benefit. And here I would just open brackets a moment and say financial benefit can also mean that you're renting your flat regularly to someone. You might not even be doing any unjust profit. You'd be just be renting someone a flat to someone who's undocumented, and you could be considered a smuggler under the EU Facilitation Directive, because they are facilitating their regular stay by providing them with a place to be. This is the current EU framework dealing with. When you are facilitating their regular entry or stay, which means, for instance, as we have seen in the past, bringing someone safe to shore, can be giving a lift to someone who's suffering from freezing weather conditions in the Italian and French Alps, it can be facilitating the transit of someone from one city to the other in the EU, then there is no requirement of financial benefit at all. And this is what opens the possibility to criminalizing human rights defenders. We also know from the discussions that happened when a facilitation directive was adopted that this is a problem that had been considered already back then, that the parliament had asked back then, well, this could risk to lead to the criminalization of human rights defenders. The parliament had also pushed for a compulsory humanitarian clause, which was not adopted. Excuse me. What the legislation says now is that member states may decide not to criminalize these actions if they're done for humanitarian purposes, but it's not an obligation. I think the problem here is bringing in line the EU legislation with international legislation. And it's something that UN, UN ODC, which works under the UN protocol on smuggling, have encouraged you to do on many occasions. So this is a bit to explain the legal difference between profit and no profit and why the EU legislation is actually not in line with international standards. Going back to your question, I think there are like a lot of different possibilities, in particular for monitoring. The Fundamental Rights Agency is already doing a lot of work in monitoring search and rescue and all the cases of criminalization of search and rescue operations. So this could, for instance, be expanded to monitor different cases of criminalization. The parliament could also have, of course, a role by creating a committee, by investigating into the criminalization of migrants and of human rights defenders. We also think that the Commission could be doing more. The Commission has a rule of law report. In the rule of report, there is now a chapter on civic space, but this could also be used more and could be implemented more. There are some windows of opportunities which are coming up, for instance, in the context of the action plan on migrant smuggling that the Commission published again last year. There is a commitment to assess again the implementation of the Facilitation Directive. And we think it's really important that the Commission, when they assess the implementation of this directive, really like collect data on how is this directive used, who are the victims of smuggling, who are like accused of smuggling under this directive. And this data is actually not available. We have been calling for the European Commission to collect data on the implementation of this directive for several times, and until now we have received no answer. So these are just a few of different actions, but as I mentioned before, I think different actions should be undertaken by different actors too, but we're very happy, I think, to discuss this further. And I also don't know if Jyoti would like to add something from the chat, because she also co-wrote the report with me and maybe would like to add more details. Thank you.
Just raise your hand and take the floor if you would like to come in. And yes, Eli, please. Oh, sorry about that. Just by written, then apologies. Just by written in the chat, if you want to add any comment, and I will hand over to Robin.
Thank you. I just wanted to react to the question about why is there no difference between made in the law between smuggling for profit and smuggling not for profit. The answer is that the it's a choice. I mean, it's a decision that was made after careful debate and reflection when the Facilitation Directive was adopted. At the time, France had the presidency of the European Union, and Nicolas Sarkozy was the president of France, and he strongly defended the position that financial advantage, financial profit, should not be a requirement for smuggling to be prosecuted, with the argument that it would complicate proceedings, it would be harder to prosecute this kind of crime because, you know, it's the same kind of argument that's used to create a broader incrimination for terrorism, for organized crime, because of course whenever you have you know, advanced networks of organization committing complicated crimes, it is harder when you have to prove the more aspects of the crime. So of course it's harder when you have to show that that there is money, that there is an account, that there is a phone, a wiretap where somebody mentions money. So it makes it complicated. But of course, whenever you hear somebody saying that, yes, just we should just make it broader and we should trust the prosecutors that they're only going to prosecute the people who are really who really should be prosecuted and not innocent people, then of course you need to remember that you know, maybe some people at the time did not imagine that so many countries in Europe would have really strong anti-migrants parties who would be part of governing coalition, you know, which was the case in Belgium when this case was brought forward. So of course everything is going to be used in the way that that these parties want to use, and so that's not an oversight, it's a choice. As for what can be done on the international law and European level, I'm clearly not informed. I'm not an insider of these levels, but really I just want to stress that everything can be useful. I mean, as a lawyer defending activists, we can use a lot of stuff, even some declaration, non-binding declaration from an international body can be used as an argument in a court of law. Of course, that's not going to win on its own, but a lot of things can help winning acquittal. And not only positions from international bodies, but really actions from people on the ground. And the kind of thing that you are doing with the Al Hiblu 3 case and that other people here are doing, it's really crucial. I mean, in the case that I was mentioning, I said it was a victory that the volunteers were acquitted, but really, honestly, they could have been convicted. I mean, it's an interpretation of the law that I strongly disagree with, but it could have been adopted. They could have said that, of course, you didn't have a financial advantage as a volunteer, but you knew that the person you were helping was that the person you were hosting was self-smuggling. You knew that they were trying to illegally cross the border. You let them use your home, your phone, your computer, so you were an accomplice of the crime. Now, it should be case law that this is not the case and this is not an interpretation that can be used anymore in Belgium, but it could have gone the other way. And really, I think the reason why it didn't go that way is because we had a network of activists supporting the people being prosecuted. There was a group called Solidarity is Not a Crime, who were not even supporting, but really working together with the volunteers, and the volunteers themselves who were being persecuted, of course they were really attentive to what was going to happen to migrants who were prosecuted with them. And based on a small core group of activists, they were able to, you know, gather support from some media figures and artists and political people, and this ended up creating media interest. And really, as a lawyer, we could feel the change in the courtroom when the courtroom is filled with people expressing support for your clients. It's a really different feeling from when it's just just your clients and police and crime journalists. So really, I just encourage people to get involved with groups in your country, and whatever your background, I'm sure there is some ways you can help.
Thank you, Robin. Yeah, criminalization is unfortunately a widespread phenomenon, but we see that when there's mobilization, and that's what you want to bring in the debate also, is that it helps. It helps preventing maybe stronger sentences, but it's also important as a political message, because we know here what is lacking is political will. This brings me to a question in the chat, and I'll be happy to give the floor to Tineke Strik, because she's working also in first line on EU legislation related to migration, and you wanted the floor also, I know. So I address the question, which is, what are your suggestions on how the EU could better sustain the right to defend rights? What could the European Parliament do in this area? Can the EU rely on the UN Special Rapporteur for Human Rights Defenders, the Commissioner of Human Rights, etc.? So, of course, we have different legislations at EU level. They're also addressed in the study. You also address a specific recommendation, policy recommendations we fully agree with, and that we are, as Greens, very strongly pushing for. The European Commission in 2023 committed to have a monitoring of the implementation guidance of the Facilitation Directive. So this will be also, for us, an important moment to act on this ground. Tineke, if you want to reply to this question and also ask your question or
thank you.
Your comments. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Saskia. Thanks for the question, which is very legitimate here with co-legislators. I want to follow up to also this Facilitation Directive and indeed the explanation why we do have this directive. It was actually made in a moment that member states could take the initiative for legislation, which is now after that it's only the Commission. But we advocated a very long time for an amendment to this directive. We didn't manage, the Commission didn't want to do so, but at least it came out with a guidance kind of recommendation in September 2020, a guidance for the member states to make use of the option to exempt humanitarian organizations. And I very much agree with you that actually it should lead to an obligation to use the option if you look at international law. And I would really hope that at a certain moment, maybe also due to national pressure from actors or lawyers or whatever, that at a certain moment there would be a kind of a judicial question, for instance, to the Court of Justice, would this option not be actually an obligation, especially if a member state acts not in accordance with the guidance from the Commission, that already leads to a question of interpretation of EU law. So that could be a reason already for a national judge to go to the Court of Justice. I think, unfortunately, we do not get anywhere only on political will. We really need to combine it with litigation so that we always have pressure from different sides, from the legal side and the political side. And I very much agree also with your outcry that why do we need more monitoring if we have so many reports already from authoritative bodies? Many UN reports, Council of Europe reports, Ombudsman reports, and yet nothing is being done with it. Maybe I may invite you for a presentation that we have tomorrow on another study. We commissioned a study on actually as a follow-up to the arguments the Commission always uses, like we don't have evidence, so we are not an investigative body, we cannot start infringement procedures, and therefore we have gathered legal arguments, because what you see is that European courts, Strasbourg and Luxembourg, they act upon reports. You know, they say, for instance, the MSF cases or other cases, that they say, look, if there's a list of consistent reports from reliable bodies, the burden of proof is on the member state to show the opposite. And otherwise, we presume that this is the reality. And this is what also the Commission could do, base itself on all those reports and go to the Court of Justice, or start at least the infringement procedures. And we want to convince the Commission more in using that and also using the funding, because we now have this conditionality, of course, for rule of law issues. But we have a lot of funds specifically for assisting border management, and where in those regulations there are very clear obligations for respecting fundamental rights. So we think that while reviewing those national plans for getting more funding, that the Commission should really assess if it's legitimate to disburse this funding, or if first the member states should start respecting the fundamental rights. And you see that the Commission has used this instrument with emergency assistance regarding Croatia and Greece, but then with a real risk that we see now of the opposite effect, namely the Commission does not oblige fundamental rights respect as such, but obliges to impose a monetary mechanism. And now we end up in dependent monitor mechanism, which come up with reports that actually nothing is wrong, that everything is fine. So this is something that really learns me that you'd better have no monitor mechanism if it ends up in that, and that we really need stronger EU criteria laid down in legislation on the requirements to such monitoring mechanisms. I mean, we have now a proposal in the screening regulation for a monitor mechanism. The scope is too small because it does not apply in the border areas, but still there's not a clear criteria on level of independence, resources, mandate. So really that we are sure that such monitor mechanisms are effective and objective. So this is what we need to fight for as a European legislators. We already see that the Council has almost deleted this whole monitor mechanism, so it will be an uphill battle, but we need to fight for that and keep on putting pressure on the Commission to act as guardian of the treaty, because it's really disgraceful. Yesterday there was this ECRA conference, and there a Commission official even admitted, look, we're not going to do this because it doesn't have any impact. So this is, of course, unacceptable. And it really helps if you keep on pushing with complaints to the Commission to make sure that it cannot be forgotten and it is on the table. And on our side, we will use that also to keep the pressure high. Thank you for my long answer. But
thank you very much. I will have to close the Q&A session so that we have time for the closing remarks and to have a coffee together, to have also informal talks. I would just like to read a last testimony going in the direction that you also explained to us from Eli Criona. She wanted to comment on your situation, Robin, in Greece. I was recently also involved in a case of a man who was charged with smuggling, eventually was convicted for facilitation of illegal entry on the basis that he facilitated his own entry and the entry of his family members. So just another example of arbitrary interpretation of these provisions. I think it was important to read it out and also to, end these exchanges with that remark. I would like to now give the floor to Michele for the main policy recommendations and concluding remarks before we end this conference.
So thank you, Saskia, and MEP Sullivan and Tinica as well, and to all of you for participating in this, Nina and the assistant for organizing this, Marta and Jyothi for the research. I wanted to start with the fact that 20 years ago, I was actually the second staff person at PICUM, and I was hired to do a book of solidarity project. It was our first EU project, and it was actually to map solidarity. It was to map basically what we've heard about today. We looked at 10 countries. We didn't look at Greece at the time. I want to specify that. But it was different 20 years ago than to hear what we've heard today. There was not the extent of the impact of all of these policies 20 years ago that we have now. And the extent of it was that if you look, we have three volumes of that book, and it basically just looks at the three different country groupings. There were hardly any cases. And the cases that there were, they were very, very minor. And I, once again, Greece was not included. And maybe Greece, probably even 20 years ago, would have been quite different. But even if we just look at some of the more recent numbers, the Rizoma project that was also mapping criminalization of solidarity said that as of December 2019, there were at least 171 people who were criminalized for solidarity. And this report says that between January 21st, 2021 and March 2022, nearly 90 people. What's the difference with these numbers? The Rizoma one looked at it for 2 to 3 years, I think. So they came up with a figure that seemed obviously very big in 2019, but this report has looked at 15 months. And in 15 months, we have nearly 90 people. And we have a disclaimer in this report that this is most likely an undercount. So we know just by the increasing reporting and monitoring, which completely agree with you, but this is also part of the process, is to show the evolution. How is this issue evolving? So from PICUM's perspective, we definitely see, unfortunately, that it is devolving. It's not evolving in a positive sense. And here I just wanted to focus on four recommendations that we've all heard today, but maybe just to kind of center them as we go forward. So the first one is to prevent the criminalization of humanitarian assistance, which requires amending the definition of smuggling. So we've just heard about that. We see within PICUM, we work on the human rights of undocumented migrants. We see that the UN usually can have higher standards when it talks about human rights of undocumented. As an example, the UN bodies and international human rights law now says in 2022 that children should never be detained for immigration purposes. It's clear. There's no more question about it. The EU Returns Directive still says it's possible. That's just one example. So we've heard today the smuggling protocol says what is unjust retribution or payment. It's very clear. It was a political choice in 2002 not to take the UN definition. So if it was a political choice then, can it be a political choice now to change it? That's kind of a first question. And Tinica said, the commission has been wrangling this issue over years and in 2020 came up with the guidelines. The guidelines are a starting point, but they still mainly talk about assistance at sea. So most of the things that we've heard about today aren't even covered by these new guidelines. So we really need the clarity. What will that be? Will that be new guidelines? Will that be a visit by the UN Special Rapporteur on Human Rights Defenders to the EU? That's also something that's been done previously by the Special Rapporteur on Migrants, something that we might consider, because Special Rapporteurs don't have to just go to countries. They can go to the region as well. And when the Special Rapporteur on Migrants, François Crapeau, at the time, when he did his visit, it actually got a lot of attention. So that's maybe one thing to consider. The second point is, okay, we've heard about the legislation. We know the challenges, but we've heard from Tajana and Omar's case and all the other ones about the harassment, when it's not even just the legislation, the ongoing years and years of harassment in all forms. So here we're talking about cultivating the civic space, better protecting human rights defenders, and developing legal and policy tools to protect human rights defenders from retaliation and invoke infringement proceedings that Tinica also talked about when there's a breach of EU law. This is also interesting that the EU is very clear about human rights defenders as long as they're outside the EU. So there is a whole policy on external affairs and human rights defenders. How about inside the EU? So that's one of the recommendations in this report. The third point, coming back to your point on monitoring and evidence base, so strengthening the human rights monitoring, solidifying the evidence base on the criminalization of migration and solidarity, and adequately funding humanitarian assistance and monitoring. I think we all recognize the limits, the frustrations that all of us play. I've been here for 20 years on this issue, basically. It's very sad to see this at the state that it is now. So we're all part of this, but we all have to, in a sense, continue evidence, because it's only also showing in the evidence that you can see the evolution. But here, the recommendations talk about the EU budget, legal aid. The EU budget is ongoing, now there are many calls, so maybe something can come through that. And the fourth and the last point, this was mentioned by Marta, by Tajana, and by others as well on the panel, that the impact of all of these policies is much harder on migrants and refugees themselves than for others. Here, we're talking about promoting and advancing a more balanced EU migration policy. The EU has an anti-racism action plan from 2020 to 2025. Would the writers of that action plan have written it differently if they had heard the panel? You've given very clear examples of individuals from Belgium who had Belgian citizenship, others who were dual nationals with Morocco, another one who had legal residence in Belgium for 17 years, four of them doing the same things, and two of them detained for different periods of time, and two of them not. Tajana and Omar's case, also another case. How can we ignore this? How can the anti-racism action plan afford to ignore it? So this is the starting point. How much of this is embedded in a system where we are taking for granted that there are anti-racism undertones, or racist undertones, I guess, to the migration policy? The child rights coordinator is newly appointed. What would the newly appointed child rights coordinator have heard about the El Hiblu 3? Two of them were children, or maybe still are. So how can we connect these dots more to also make links with some of the other policies? And I think that's what I would also end with. I think it was, you had made the comment also that, is this an EU strategy to criminalize? Unfortunately, I think with all the evidence, there's actually not many more questions. I guess the question to us is, how can we make it a strategy to decriminalize? How can we have as a complete of a strategy? Looking at least in this report, there's almost 15 policy tools and areas just on the EU level. There's so many on the national level, media, research, journalists. So I think it's very comprehensive. We'll continue to work together. But once again, it is solidarity and support. So thank you very much to MEPs as well.
Thank you, Michele LeVoy, for this concluding remarks, director of PICUM. Sorry, I didn't introduce you beforehand. And of course, a warm thank you to PICUM and the authors, co-authors of the study, because of course, asking for such a study is a way to contribute to this collection of evidence and to show the widespread issue of a criminalization of solidarity we want to together fight against. And I think you really concluded well by saying, let's keep working all together because we're stronger together, civil society, end in end with the policy sides and the political groups that go towards the same direction. We will keep campaigning on solidarity is not a crime. We will keep fighting politically in this house every time we can, in every file, at every alert that you send us, in order to have a EU strategy to decriminalize and to make solidarity the first principle and humanity the first principle again in migration and asylum issues. I want to also thank you for participating. Thanks to all the speakers in the panel for your precious time, your testimonies, and your contributions. Also to the remote participants, sorry, it's always a frustrating exercise because we couldn't ask all the questions that came in the chat, but I'm sure, as you said, that we will have other moments to have exchanges and to work together. And last but not least, warm thank you to the staff also, Nina, Liz, and all the others that put a lot of work and energy in this. I now want you to invite you for a coffee break and have an informal discussion before to leave each other. Thank you very much.